Today in this lecture, we will discuss the new product development processes. Oh, what is new product? So new product is a product that is being introduced by the company or the organization to the world. So if you see that, how can we give a new product to the world? The company can obtain new product through two ways. One is acquisition, or it is known as the buy, or second is the new product development, that is make. It means the company has only two options available with them. Either they can go to make the product or buy the product. Some of the example of new product is here is the mobile phone. When this come to the world, there may be the modified new product, the product we are seeing nowadays, the mobile with the new features and add-on. Acquisition is basically refers to the buying of a whole company, a patent or a license to produce someone else's product. While in case of new product development refers to original product. Original product means that this product is for the very first time. Maybe product involvement improvement is involved, product modification, a new brand develops from the firm's own research and development. So all are the example of new product. If you talk about the type of new products, so as I already mentioned that there is only two type of new product. One is known as the new to the world and modified new product. So the new to the world means that the product is not pre-existential. People do not know about this particular product and this has been come for the very first time. And modified new product means, yes, it is existing product which has been modified. And modification may be in terms of their quality, maybe quantity, maybe the color, maybe the packaging, maybe some of the ingredient has been changed. For example, Maggi noodle. So noodle when introduced in the for the first time, it is the new to the world. If I talk about the Maggi itself, that the Maggi, the regular Maggi that we used to get, now there is a different variants. The Atta Maggi, the oat Maggi, typically rice dal Maggi like this. So these are nothing but this is a modified new product. And in this world, there is less than 5% of the product belongs to the category that is new to the world, and remaining around 95% to 96% of the new product that we see usually belongs to the second category, that is the modified new product. Why we have a very less new product that belongs to the category new to the world? The obvious reason is there is a high rate of failure of new product, and the reason may be overestimation of market size. Our product, new product, failed into the market because as a management we failed to overestimated the size of market. But when in real sense, when we start marketing the product, that we fail to see that our market is not that much big. So the product fails. Maybe the product has poor designing. It is not performing the job that is supposed to perform. Maybe incorrect positioning. We are not able to position our product in a right manner. The example may be, Vaseline, that is generally known for a petroleum jelly. When Vaseline has introduced the talcum powder, so talcum powder was not perceived positively by the people. The only reason is that people thought that it is also a kind of a sticky substance. The wrong timing is the another reason for the product failure. Sometimes we launch the product that is not required at that particular time. People are not convinced about that particular product idea, and thus the product fails. So there is n number of product that is example of a wrong timing, that product is not required. Then sometimes the product failed because the product price is very high. At that time people are not able to afford such product, and they fail to capture the market, and ultimately they fail. Inefficient promotion. Promotion is a tool which make people aware about their product availability. They give incentive to buyer to buy or take action. But if we are not doing ample promotion activities, so people are not aware about the product They are not even know about whether the such product is existing or not. They do not have any awareness about the features and benefit of product, and then they fail to make a market. Sometimes management does influence toward the product failure. Basically, sometimes it happens that it is the management who is not convinced about the new product. They are not readily promoting their product, etc. High development cost is another reason for the failure, because development require a lot of cost, time, money and effort, and every organization don't have these facilities. So they cannot afford such high development cost, and sometimes they do not sufficiently fund their new product development process, and ultimately come with a low grade quality product. And competition do kill the new product development. Suppose there is a one player A who has produced a new product, and their competitor who is sound in finance and their development capacity, production capacity, they may produce a better product vis-a-vis to their competitor and might be priced at low cost, that kill the new product. New product development process is basically a eight stage processes, and I will deliberate it one by one. Let us just see what are the various stages of new product development process. The first stage is idea generation. Second is idea screening. Third is concept development and testing. Fourth is market strategy development. Business analysis, product development, market testing, and commercialization. So every product that we want to develop as a new product must definitely pass through these eight stages. So let us see one by one. The first one is known as idea generation. Before producing any new product means that the product must have new features, new attributes, then only it is considered as a new product. So a new product only comes out when we have some new ideas in our mind. Without having new idea, one cannot make a new product. So the company must encourage their people to come with a new product concept, new product idea, so that they are able to give birth to new product. So new product idea generation is basically a systematic search for new product idea. And for this, company can use two type of source for new product idea generation. They are internal and external. Internal source refers to the company's own formal research and development wing. They have their R&D facilities, their management, staff, and entrepreneurial programs. So how does the company use these internal sources? These internal sources can be used because these are the people who are part and parcel of their product development, their marketing strategy. So they know what are the various challenges, what are the various opportunities. So they obviously come out with new idea that will help them to produce new product. There is an external source as well, as that is beyond the company, that is outside the company, namely is the customer. Customer who use the product, they know what are the various challenges they are facing with their product they are using. They may give some of the suggestion to the company. They may point out the challenges they are facing with this difficulties basically facing with this product. What sort of improvement they are looking for, they will act as a source for the new idea. Competitor also, you can copy, you can see the product of the competitor. You can do reverse engineering about their product, and then if there is any sort of gap, then a new idea can be generated. Distributor, supplier, they also closely deal with the consumer. Consumer give their feedback to them. They can share these valuable information with the company, and they are also dealing with the different type of competitive product also. So they act as an important source for the idea generation. And yes, there is another outside designing firm, there is an exhibition, etc., which keep on coming with new idea about the products. The idea generation has different techniques, and these techniques are generally namely as a brainstorming, nominal group technique, and Delphi technique. So let us understand what is brainstorming. Brainstorming is a technique where people who has some idea, it may be a group of consumer, it has a group of R&D people, management, worker, etc. It may be anyone who may give some new ideas about anything, though they are the part of brainstorming session. So people are invited in a group of 8 to 10 people. They are given with some of the product and they are free to give whatever idea and opinion they have in their mind about that particular product. And there is a one facilitator or moderator who keep on jotting down their point. And in brainstorming, people are generally not allowed to criticize each other's viewpoint. And there is another variation of brainstorming, which is known as reverse brainstorming. Under this brainstorming process, whenever someone gives some idea, the other people can criticize them. They can straight away, right away, can say that this particular idea is not feasible. So this is the brainstorming technique, where people deliberately sit together, think, ponder about the new product features and attributes. Then another technique that is used is nominal group technique, and which is also referred as NGT. So nominal group technique is quite similar to the brainstorming, with only difference that instead of giving their oral opinion or idea, they can jot down their opinion and idea on a piece of paper and then given to the moderator. Then moderator can take out the common point from participant and then they can deliberate upon it. The third one is the Delphi technique. The Delphi technique is generally use the expert from that particular field that might not be physically present at one point of time or a place. They are then under Delphi technique, they give them the questionnaire, their opinion to different expert. They give their opinion, then they interpret the data, then they give them the responses or feedback to every expert, and again they have, if they do not have same opinion, then they can again give their opinion, etc. So this is the Delphi technique that is used. There are certain techniques that is used for stimulating the creative thinking, and these are listed as attribute listing, force relationship, morphological analysis, reverse assumption analysis, new context, and mind mapping. It is very interesting to know these different stimulating technique. So let us talk about the first one. It is attribute listing. Attribute listing is basically, under this, the people who are generating new idea list the attribute of an object. For example, if they want to make some screwdriver, so they have jotted down the attribute. Then modify each attribute, for example, replacing the wooden handle with a plastic one, providing a torque power, or adding different screw heads, and so on. This is how, if they keep deliberate on different attributes, they come with a new product. Another is force relationship. Under this, they list several ideas and consider each in relation to each of the others. Suppose they have three ideas, so every idea is considered in relation to remaining two. For example, if designing a new office furniture, one can consider a desk, bookcase, and filing cabinet as separate idea. So here we have a three idea. One is the desk, second one is bookcase, third is filing cabinet. Now we will consider desk with bookcase and filing cabinet, then desk with filing cabinet, bookcase with filing cabinet, like this. Then they imagine a desk with a built-in bookcase, or a desk with built-in file, or a bookcase with a built-in file. So this is the example of your force relationship. The third one is morphological analysis. How this morphological analysis is different from first two? In attribute listing and force relationship, we are no more bothered about the problem. But under morphological analysis, the morphological analysis start with a problem, such as getting something from one place to another via a powered vehicle. Suppose the manufacturer has this problem in their hand, that they want to get something from one place to another via a powered vehicle. So now they will think about the different dimensions, and the different dimension may include what is the type of platform they will use. It may be a chair, it may be some sling, it may be some bed. Then they will consider another dimension such as the medium. The medium may be water, the medium may be air, the medium may be oil or rail. Then they will also think about the another dimension, that is the how they are going to power it. The power may be compressed air, may be electrical motor, may be magnetic field, etc. So they list down every possible combination to generate a new solution. The fourth one is reverse assumption analysis. So under this process, what we do basically, we list all the normal assumption about an entity and then we reverse them. For example, the normal assumption that restaurant has menu, charge for food, serve food. Now reverse these assumption. So now when we are going to reverse this assumption, the new restaurant may decide to serve only, as it was the last assumption. What the chef had brought that morning and cooked may provide some food and charge only for how long the person sit at the table, and may design an exotic atmosphere and rent out the space to people who bring their own food and beverages. So this is how they are moving from the reverse direction, that is the reverse assumption analysis. The next one is next new context. The new context means it takes familiar process such as people helping services and put them into a new context. Imagine helping robots, right? So this is how they are doing. Serving by the people is one of the feature, but now they are changing the context, now serving by the robots. And the last one is mind mapping. Under mind mapping start with a very central idea which is being jotted down on a piece of paper, and then we think about the what are the various different aspects and how it is linked with that particular central theme, and then they come with a new association and idea. So this is the technique that stimulate our creativity. The second one is known as idea screening. Idea screening is basically once we have a pool of idea. Now it is not possible that every idea has the same potential to become a new product. There are certain idea that is very promising, there are idea that is not that much promising, or maybe a very poor idea. So under idea screening, what do we do? Basically we review all the new product idea and drop the poor ones as soon as it is possible. And while doing idea screening, we may commit two type of error. These are known as go error and drop error. So the go error is basically accepting a poor idea. Somehow a poor idea is being carried forward for successive stage that may not be very promising. And sometime it happens that a very good idea is dropped and it has not passed on to successive stage, and this is known as the drop error. So one example of drop error is that Nokia, when giving a phone of a QWERTY keyboard, he has come across of a phone that without a keyboard, but they have not given this feature into their product, and the Android phone has overtaken the market. So for this is the drop error for the company. Once the concept, our idea has been screened, passed, selected, then it is the time when we have to test the concept. We have to develop the concept and test. Now there are certain keywords we have to understand. There is a product idea. Basically, product idea is an idea for a possible product that is company can see itself offering to the market. There is a product concept. Product concept is a detailed version of idea stated in a meaningful consumer term. Because concept is something vague, some idea in the mind. Now you have to give a meaningful version of your idea to the consumer. And the product image is the way consumer perceive an actual or potential product. How does your product is being visualized by the consumer? What kind of image they are going to make? So concept, what is basically a concept? Concept is basically an idea that we have in our mind. A product idea can be turned into several concepts. For example, there is a concept called an instant breakfast drink for adult who wants to quick nutrition breakfast without preparation. So this may be the one of the concept. The second concept may be a tasty snacks for children to drink as a midday refreshment. Another concept may be a health supplement for older adult to drink in the late evening before they go to the bed. So the company may have several concepts in their mind, and each concept represents a category concept that define the product's competitions. Right? This is how we have to see that instant breakfast drink. How does the company can give a instant breakfast drink for the people who are very busy in their day-to-day life? They do not have even time to prepare their breakfast. Now there is a another concept of tasty snack for children to drink as a midday refreshment. Now students are children are in schools, parents are not with them, so how to give them something nutritional that they can easily drink? And there is a people who are very old. They do not have people who can look after them. So how to give them some product that they can have something nutritional? They can simply take it out from the fridge and they can have it even before going to their bed. So these are the different concepts that they have to give to the consumer. And before giving that the concept testing means presenting a product concept symbolically or physically to target consumer and getting their reaction. It means whatever concept we have mind, as I have already discussed three concepts regarding the nutritional food, so this has to be given in a symbolically or to the physically to the target customer. And in our case, the target consumer are the adult people who are very busy. There is a children's and the older adults. So these are the and what are their reaction? Whether it is so that consumer are liking our product, whether they have a very positive reaction towards whatever concept we are given. It might be possible that yes, people are very busy, but they want to have some instant breakfast, but they don't want in terms of drink. They want to be something as a food. Maybe children like the concept of having the nutritional snacks that they can drink, but might be their parent cannot like it because they may not able to handle it properly. So these thing has to be tested before going to the market strategy development. If the product concept is perceived in a very positive manner, people sound that they like our product, if the product is available in the market, they will definitely buy it. Then we have to go for the fourth stage, that is the market strategy development. So marketing strategy development refers to initial marketing strategy for introducing the product to the market. So what are the product that we are going to launch in the market? What sort of marketing strategy? What is our product? What is our pricing? How we are going to promote it? How we are going to distribute it? How we are going to capture more market share? These are the marketing strategy that we have to give. And every marketing strategy statement has three part. The first part deals with the description of target market size. What is the size of target market in which they are want to launch their product? What is the structure? What is the composition of that particular target market? Maybe in terms of gender, in terms of income group, education, social economic strata. So these are the structure. And what is the behavior of the consumer at that particular target market? And second is how they are going to position their product. What is the sales? What is the market share? And what is the gross profit goal of that particular company for a few years, for 2 to 3 years? So they must have such kind of strategy. The second part deals with the pricing, distribution, and marketing budget for few years, while the third part deals with the long-term sales, profit goal, and marketing mix strategy. So every company who wants to develop a new product must develop their marketing strategy statement, so for a few year to the longer term, because the company work with the intention of perpetuality. not for only for a very shorter period of a time. After doing this, the company, this stage moved to the business analysis, which involve a review of sales, cost and profit projection to find out whether they can satisfy the company's objective or not. So the company may have objective of sales maximization, profit maximization, customer satisfaction, and at the same time, in order to achieve all these things, company have to have more revenue, better sales. They have to know how to reduce the cost, what is their profit projection, so that they can ensure that the longer sustainability and survival of the company. If till these five stages company are getting positive responses, then company must look for product development also. So product development is a process where company produce the product in a physical form. Some of the prototypes is being manufactured, developed, and this is being tested. So product development involves the creation and testing of one or more physical version by the R&D or engineering department. It require an increase in investment. It is a very expensive method. It is an expensive activity where company has to infuse lot of money, time, resources in order to develop new product. So company has to check, develop it, and then at the same time, when the prototype is being developed, the product has to be tested. And this testing is known as customer testing. And customer testing has done on two level. One is known as alpha and second is beta. Alpha testing tests the product within the organization to see how it performs in different applications. And after redefining or refining the prototype further, the company may move to the beta testing in real life with the real customer. Now let us understand what is alpha testing and beta testing with one of the example. Suppose a company come with a new idea of making a helmet. The helmet is unique in some of feature. Let's say it shows it has the inbuilt speedometer, it has this inbuilt map in it, or it may have some security feature as well. For example, if we met with an accident, it will dial numbers to the people, to their relatives. Let us these three features. So once this helmet has been developed by R&D department, their engineering department, and then some of the prototype, now it is being handed to the company people. They will test this product within the premises of the organization. This is known as alpha testing. And if some of the flaws has been found, if certain modification is required, they do carry out and they come with the final product. And now it is time that this particular product has to test in the exact, in real market scenario, in real world. Then this helmet has been delivered to some of the test marketer or the tech expert. In case of the helmet, this will be given to some of the biker who is the test biker. So they will wear it, they will test in different condition in the real market or real life. So then if it is very successful, then company can go for the mass production, and then company will decide their testing of the product, and once it is successful, then they will go for the mass production and commercialization. One thing I would like to bring to your notice that might be you have seen a car running on a road which is covered with a black cloth. Only the windshield is seen and rest of the car is totally covered with a black cloth. Now that particular car is covered with black cloth because the car is under the beta testing. The car is being driven by some test driver in the real life situation. So people don't want to disclose the design, the color, the different types of style. Therefore, it has hided all the details. Only they want to run on the real road to get the real experience. So this is your product development and customer market test. Now the next one is our test marketing. Now test marketing is the state at which the product and marketing product are introduced into more realistic marketing setting. So far we have some of the notions, some of the ideas, assumption that this marketing program may be more effective, this marketing or the product will be effective to such a manner or to such an extent, but we cannot see anything with surety because we have not tested it, we have not tried it. Maybe what sounds very promising at the time of inception or conception of ideas and product development might be a total failure, or maybe vice versa. So it is a time when we have to check both our product, both our marketing strategies. Test marketing provide the marketer with experience in testing the product and entire marketing program before full introduction of product. Now there is a question. It is not so that every organization, every firm go for test marketing. There are certain firms that go for test marketing. There are a number of firms or organizations that don't go for test marketing. So let us understand what are the conditions when the marketer must have to go for test marketing and what are the conditions where a company may or may not go for the test marketing. So let us understand the first one is when the firm must have to have test marketing. The first condition that when the company's new product incur a large investment, when company has put a lot of money, lot of resources, time, money, etc., everything, and which has a major impact on the entire market, that the product must have been properly tested before launching the product. The example that any medicine, any food cannot be launched in the market without any test marketing, because it has number of requirement that it must be satisfy customer. It does not create harmful effect, so large investment is required. And the second is when the company is not very sure about the success of their product or their marketing program, they definitely company must do a market testing. They must test the their product into a market in a small segment. If they have a better and promising result, then they can go for the full commercialization. So there are number of cases where company or the firm may not go for test marketing, and the obvious reason are that when they are going for simple line extension. The simple line extension means suppose a company is manufacturing a soap and they have their soap are very successful, their marketing strategy is well tested, and now they are simply introducing another brand of soap. So they need not to go for test marketing because they are simply making a product that is very successful. The marketing strategy they are following is obviously very same for the new product, so they need not to go for the any test marketing. This is basically a line extension. In case of copy of competitor product, many time it happened that manufacturer simply copy the competitor product with some of the modification. So the company need not to go for the test marketing. The obvious reason is that if the competitor product is very successful, their strategy is very successful, then obviously your product and your marketing strategy will be very successful because it is simply a copy of your competitor. So you are just replicating the process product of your competitor with little bit modifications. The third reason may be when your cost of investment is low, then in this case company may not choose to test market because sometimes it happens the cost of test marketing is higher than the cost of production. So if it is the case, then companies would forego the test marketing. And the fourth one is when management confidence. Obviously, if the management is very, very much confident about the product they are producing or they are about to launch, or they are very confident about their marketing strategy planning, then they need not to go invest money into test marketing. Now coming to what are the approaches to test marketing, and our focus will be only a consumer good market testing. I will not discuss the business goods testing. There are four dimensions generally we consider while testing our consumer good market. This is the trial. The second is the first purchase, then adoption, and what is their frequency purchase. So many consumer may try the product but not rebuy it, or it might achieve high permanent adoption but low purchase frequency. So here are the different methods that we will see. So why these four dimension is very important for us? So it may happen that many consumers may try our product. It may happen if we are doing a free sampling, people will try our product, but when comes to first purchase, they don't rebuy it. It may be the case, so they don't go for the first purchase. And sometimes it happens that yes, they have a high adoption rate, they do buy our product, they like our product, but their purchase frequency is very low. So we have to check all these things into four dimensions, that is trial, first purchase, adoption and purchase frequency. Now there is a different methods we have. Major methods for consumer market test marketing are namely sales wave research, simulated test market, control test market and test markets. So these are the four important methods of consumer good marketing. And obviously the first sales wave research is least costly, and the test market, the fourth one, is the most costly. So let us take one by one that what is sales wave research. Under sales wave research, consumers who initially try the product at no cost are re-offered it or a competitor's product at slightly reduced price. The offer may be made as many as five times, which is generally referred as a sales wave, while the company note how many customers select it again and their reported level of satisfaction. So what does we do in sales research? We generally offer our product to the consumer without charging any money. At the same time, we offer competitor product at slightly reduced price from their actual price. So we want to say whether people will buy our product or the competitor product, and this is usually done for the five times. The sales wave research can be implemented very quickly. It can be conducted with a fair amount of security and carried out without final packaging and advertisement of the product. So we need not to do a packaging or advertisement. We can just go to the marketplace and we can give this product to our consumer to buy. We are offering for free, or for the competitor product, it may be at a lower cost. The second one is simulated test market. Under this method, 30 to 40 qualified shoppers are asked about brand familiarity and preference in a specific product category and attend a brief screening of both well-known and new TV commercial or print ad. One ad advertisements the new product but is not singled out for attention. Customer receive a small amount of money and are invited into store where they may buy any item. The company note how many consumers buy the new brand and competing brand. This provide a measure of the ad's relative effectiveness against competing ad in simulating trial. This method can give some surprisingly accurate result on advertisement effectiveness and trial rate in a much shorter time and at a fraction of cost of using real test market. So basically under this process, we choose a 30 to 40 consumer qualified shoppers, and we portray them the advertisement of our product and competitor, and then check their responses. The third one is control test market. Under control test market, the company with a new product specifies a number of stores and geographical location it wants to test. A research firm delivers the product to a panel of participating stores and controls self-positioning, pricing and number of facings, displays and point of purchase promotion. Electronic scanner measures sales at checkout. The company can also evaluate the impact of local advertising and promotion and interview the sample of customer later to get their impression of the product. It does not have to use its own sales force, give trade allowances or buy distribution. Control test marketer provide no information about how to sell the trade on carrying the new product. And the fourth one is test market. Under test market, the ultimate way to test a new product to put into the full-blown test market. The company choose a few representative city and put on full marketing communication campaign. And the sales force try to sell the trade on carrying the product and giving it good self-exposure. Test marketing also exposes the impact of alternative marketing plan by implementing them in different cities. While doing test market, the management face several decisions. It may be they have to decide how many test cities they will select. Most tests use 2 to 6 cities. Now the another question, which cities they have to select, where they have good media coverage, maybe cooperative chain store, average competitive activities. What should be the length of this test? Whether it should be for few months to few years? What information to collect? The another important decision they have to take, what sort of information they will collect out of this test marketing? Whether they want to know the implementation of effectiveness of advertisement, customer panel, their buying characteristic, loyalty, and what action to take. If the test market show there is a high trial and repurchase rate, the marketer should launch the product nationality. If the high trial rate and low repurchase rate, redesign or drop the product. If low trial rate and high repurchase rate, develop marketing communication to convince more people. If trial and repurchase rate are both low, abandon the product. So there are different type of decision the company has to take after this test marketing. If the company's product is successfully passed all 7 stages, then it is time to make it commercialization. So commercialization is the introduction of new product. And there are two type of commercialization. One is known as the full-blown commercialization and another is rollout commercialization. Full-blown commercialization means the product is being introduced to the entire geographical area at one go, at once. While in case of rollout commercialization, company introduce their product in a phase-wise. Let's say for India, if a particular product, let's say talk about the Pepsi or Coca-Cola, whenever they come with their new product, they introduce their product into the entire India. That is known as the full-blown commercialization. Under rollout commercialization, it may happen that this product is being introduced in, let's say in the South India first, and after its success, over 3 to 6 months or maybe 1 year, it will be introduced to the North India or maybe to the entire India. So this is known as the rollout commercialization. Now the question comes in the, they have to take decision that when to launch, what is the timing, whether it is a first entry, whether it is a parallel entry or a late entry. The first entry means entering the market usually enjoy the first mover advantage of looking up the key distributor. So if you are entering your product, if you are launching the product for the first time, despite of your competitor, so this is known as the first entry, and the first entry always get the first mover advantage. But the only problem with this is that if your product is not good, if your strategy is not good, then first entry can backfire. The parallel entry is a time of which the entry coincide with the competitor entry. When your competitor is launching a product, at the same time if you are launching a product, it is known as the parallel competitor. So the market may pay more attention when two companies are advertising the new product. And the late entry, the firm may delay the launch until their competitor has borne the cost of educating the market. So it is another very good strategy that when to launch. If your competitor has launched the product, they are making people aware, they are educating the people, you can take advantage of them. You can now delay your launch of the product so that by the time your competitor is making them everybody educated, then you can make then you can enter into the market. This is known as the late entry. Second decision is the where to launch. It is basically a geographic strategy. So generally it is used in case of rollout commercialization. Then we have to decide what are the potential market, what are the local reputation of the company, so that company can launch it. So any company which is very dominating in the South Indian can di not directly launch their product into the North India. For example, we have seen Muthoot Finance and some of the finance company which are operating for so many long period in the South India, and now they are starting their operation in the North India. So that is the geographical strategy has to be seen. The third is to whom, is the who is your target market. So within the rollout market, the company must target initial distribution and promotion to best prospect group, and later that may be their early adopter, heavy user, and later on they can move to the another market. So while doing commercialization, that company has to see these things, that what should be their timing of introduction, what are the geographical area where they will have good response, and who are their target market to whom they have to give their product. So the company has to go these phases of new product development. So just to reiterate that how a company is who is deciding to produce a new product moves the successive stage. So the stages are idea generation, idea screening, concept development and testing, market strategy development, business analysis, product development, market testing, and commercialization. Now, once the product is commercialized, now it is available, now we have to see what is the adoption process, how people are adopting the product. So adoption is basically an individual decision to become a regular user of the product. As we have seen that the consumer may buy the product only for try, they may go for first purchase, they may be a loyal customer, and might be they are purchasing on a regular basis. So adoption is basically individual decision to become a regular user of a product. It has a sequence of event beginning with consumer awareness of a new product, leading to trial usage and culminating in full and regular use of new product. The adoption process, the adopter of new product have been observed more through 5 stages. So it has the 5 stages. Well, we go for adoption new product. So one must have to pass through these 5 stages. The first one is the awareness. Under this process stage, the consumer become aware of the innovation but lack information about it. It means the consumer somehow know about yes, such product is available, but he do not have the detailed information about it. So when consumer is aware, now the sixth stage is that is the interest. The consumer is simulated to see information about the innovation. Now he want to simulated to seek information about the. Now he try to collect the information from different sources. The third one is evaluation. The consumer consider whether to try the innovation or not. Be in terms of money, be in terms be feasibility, their requirement. So they try to evaluate it with the existing product. Then the fourth one is trial. The consumer may try the innovation to improve his or her estimate of his value. Now he may consider that we must try it only for once, and if he like the product, if the product promise that he is delivering the value, then consumer may adopt it. The consumer decide to make full and regular use of innovation. For example, one thing that Indians usually have stuffed parathe and homemade chapati, vegetable, idli, poha, upma as a breakfast. Now, if the company is making aware that the oat is good for health, and now people are looking, so now the first stage is company as the consumer come to know, okay, there is some substance called oat, which is a barley, a kind of barley. So oat is good for them, but they do not have much information about. So now they visit the website, or maybe they go through the advertisement, or maybe leaflet. They search it, and they come across about their nutritional values. This is the interest, and after this, they try to evaluate it, maybe in terms of their convenience, maybe in terms of price, maybe in terms of utility, they evaluate. And then when it comes to habit, they go for us one small pack of, let's say, of 10 rupees that will give one meal, and they cook it, they try it, and if it is, it tastes well, if it is within their affordability, then they go decide to have a full and regular use of this particular new product, that is the oat, and then they go for and buy for a bigger pack. So this is how the adoption process moves. And there is a one consumer adoption process in an aggregative perspective. So there are five group of people. One is known as innovator. The second one is early adopter. The third one is early majority, then late majority, and the last one is the laggard. So this is how this adoption process aggregated. So whenever new product comes into the market, the people who buy the product at a very initial launch are known as the innovator, and generally it comprises only of 2.5% of the population. As we move into this curve, then there is the people who start buying the product, and these are known as the early adopter, and which again comprise of 13.5% of population. Therefore, in the very beginning, we have discussed that what are the reason of failure of a product, because the success of product is largely depend on these two group of people, which is basically 16% of the population. If it is liked by these 16% of people, then this particular product moved to the early majority, means these are the group of people, they will buy the product until it reached to the, before it reached to the maturity stage. So there are 34% of the population, and then as it peaked, then slowly it demands, it tends to decline, new competitor come into play. So there is a people who are known as a late majority, but still there are 16% of people who do not buy the product initially, and they are the known as laggards. So let us just reiterate and understand what are innovators. So innovators are basically technological enthusiasts. They are venturesome and enjoy thinking with new product and mastering their intricacies. In return for low price, they are happy to conduct alpha and beta testing and report on early weaknesses. So these people, these type of people are termed as an innovator. Then early adopters are opinion leaders who carefully search for new technologies that might give them dramatic competitive advantage. They are less price sensitive and willing to adopt the product if given personalized solution. So they are the people who are looking for the personalized solution and goes service support. Then comes the third group of people, that is known as the early majority. They are deliberate pragmatics who adopt the new technology when its benefit are proven. When product is very successful, every people is now talking about the product. Now these are the people they will enter. So when its benefit are proven and a lot of adoption has already taken place, they make up the mainstream market. There are people, that is the number is around 34% of people, they are basically spectacle, conservative, who are risk averse. They are not ready to take risk. They are very technologically shy people, and they are very price sensitive, because initially the product is costly. As gradually the product cost reduces, now they can take a risk of having these products, and they are marked as a late majority. And the last group of people, that is around 16% of population, they are known as the laggards. So laggards are basically a tradition bound people. They are not ready to take risk. They are very traditionally bound people, and they resist the innovation until the status quo is no longer definable. So these are the five group of people in the adoption process, are namely innovators, early adopters, early majority, late majority, and laggards. So my dear student, we have seen how new product is being developed, what are the different types of new product, what are the various reason why the new product fail in the market, There is a 8 stages of new product development process, and finally we have seen what are the process a consumer undergo when it comes to the adoption of that particular product, what are the different types of people in the market that decide the adoption and that decide the success of any product. So my dear student, thank you very much.